Hello and welcome to Big Picture. I'm Vishal Dahiya, and today we will take up the case for legislative impact assessment. Now, the winter session of Parliament is all set to begin on 18th of November and will conclude on 13th December. Ahead of this month-long session, the chairman of Rajya Sabha, M. Venkaiah Naidu, has advocated detailed legislative impact assessment. Now, he has called for informed lawmaking in the country by bringing out social, economic, environmental and institutional impacts of legislative proposals. This, he said, will help in realizing the stated objectives of various laws. So how can such assessment be made a part of the lawmaking process and how will it benefit? For more on this, we are joined by a distinguished panel of guests in the studio today. Let me first introduce the guests, beginning with Mr. Chakshu, Head of Outreach, PRS Legislative. We have with us Ms. Aditi Phadnis as well, Political Editor, Business Standard. And we're also joined by Mr. PDT Achary, former Secretary General of Lok Sabha, and a constitutional expert as well. Let me first begin with you, Chakshu, and let's look at this concept specifically, the legislative impact assessment. Now, the way laws are made in our country, they go through a particular thorough process. You know, there is a pre-legislative thought, then there are detailed discussions, and then a draft is made, a bill is brought, a bill is discussed in the parliament, and then it is passed. So what are we trying to, add on to here when we say that we should also look into legislative impact assessment?
Vishal, I think, when the Vice President talked about legislative impact assessment, he was talking about the wider role of the institution of Parliament when it comes to lawmaking. You rightly pointed out that the legislative process has a number of principles behind it. The pre-legislative principle is that there is wider consultation and inputs taken from experts before you make a law. You bring the law to Parliament, you have a detailed scrutiny in both the houses and you also have a detailed scrutiny in the committee. And then after the law is passed, does the responsibility of Parliament end? Parliament is supposed to be a lawmaking institution, but what does lawmaking mean? Does the responsibility of Parliament ends after the law is made? Laws themselves require that a lot of the operational delegated legislation, that is created under the law comes back to Parliament. Mm-hmm. But Parliament also has the responsibility of holding the government accountable. So let's take, for example, recently in the previous session of Parliament, the Motor Vehicles Bill was passed. The idea and the intent behind the Motor Vehicles Bill was to ensure, safety of, people using roads, ensuring that accident victims, get proper and timely help. Now, whether the stated or the intended objective of the law is achieved or not, Parliament should be looking at that also. Because if the law's intended objectives are not being achieved, does the law require tweaking? Does, more thought need to go into the process or not? And there are some mechanisms which already exist. So, for example, the Vice President has also referred to the fact of social impact assessment. Under the land acquisition law, before land is acquired, there's a fair amount of social impact assessment done. Under various laws, before big projects are set up, there's an environmental impact assessment done before you set up a mine or before you set up a big manufacturing plant. So the conversation about where does Parliament's position be, does it simply end after it signs off on a law?
Okay.
Or does it have the requirement also to look at the laws that it has passed? Because every law comes with a statement of objects and, objects and reasons. Whether those objects and reasons are being met or not is something that Parliament should be looking at. Is perhaps what the Vice President is referring to.
Okay, so basically the post-enactment assessment, which Chakshu is pointing out. Let me bring Mr. Achary here first before I go to Aditi. Mr. Achary, if you look at the way, and again, the process which I described earlier, all of us know and are very well aware of that, the way laws are made here. So in terms of assessing the impact of legislations, how is it that this process can be added on to further so that we can have this particular element as well?
See, the impact, that legislative impact assessment, that is the idea which the Honorable Vice President has given. Now, legislative impact means after the law is made and after the law is enforced, how does it impact the society? And somebody studies the impact. See, over a period of time, that is what the impact assessment is, it means. It cannot be a pre-legislative assessment, I mean pre-legislative period. Mm-hmm. That kind of consultation, you know, takes place, and you mentioned perhaps a wider consultation, which may not be the case all the time. Because government basically brings the bill. Mm-hmm. And government brings the bill under various circumstances. Sometimes, of course, the society feels strongly about the need to have a legislation on certain issues. And then the government brings a bill. But at other times, the government itself thinks that a particular legislation is necessary. For example, the Right to Information Act amendment, nobody demanded it. The society did not ask for it, but the government brought it. Similarly, the UAPA, you know, an amendment was brought and made a very radical change in that. Mm-hmm. So I don't think there was any such great demand from the society as such, but maybe government got some inputs from security agencies and all that. I'm not going into the merit of that. But the point is that that is different. And impact of a legislation, that has to be done by some agencies. We don't have any kind of institutional arrangement for making an, I'm studying the impact of legislations on the society or various segments of the society.
Okay.
That is not there at all. So I think it's a good idea. In fact, it's an academic, can be an academic exercise. Well, this will help the government and also the society at large if you make a good study of the impact of a legislation. For example, RTI. Again, I will refer to the RTI. Now, although no such study has been done, but everybody feels in general that that was one of the most important legislations that this parliament has ever made. Mm-hmm. Because of its widespread impact on the people. That is the thing. So that if you can make such a study, an institutional kind of arrangement for making a study of the impact of legislations, I think that would be better. That would be good the society.
Okay. Let me bring in Aditi here. Aditi, over the years, you've seen laws being enacted, made, debated, amendments being then brought in as well to try and improve those laws again. So when we say, the chairman of the Rajya Sabha is indicating that we should look at the impact assessment of all these legislations, it's basically to try and institutionalize the process, as Mr. Achary was pointing out, so that it becomes a formal way of looking at how things are?
Well, nothing comes out of midair. Everything has a context, everything has a history. And lawmaking equally is a product of contemporary thinking and equal chance to everyone, to all forces, to participate in India's development. So, for instance, to add to Mr. Achary's point, I'd just like to draw your attention to the Data Protection Bill, which is in the making now. Mm-hmm. This has profound and wide implications on the form of commerce that nobody ever thought existed, even 15 years ago. So, we are now faced with a situation where you can say anything to anybody online and you won't be hauled up. You can adopt any practice and you won't be hauled up. You can adopt any commercial practice and you won't be hauled up. So there has to be a level playing field for everybody. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping that when the Personal Data Protection Bill, which I understand now is being expanded to be a data protection bill, which means not just personal data but all data will be covered by this legislation.
Okay.
It will address a challenge that exists in contemporary societies. Because our society is changing so fast, it's possible that this bill also may become obsolete, maybe in the next 2 years, who knows.
Okay.
And as it has happened in the past, FERA became FEMA, the anti-terror laws were found to be inadequate and some were found to be too adequate, so tweaking was done.
Okay.
So, I'm just saying that even if you don't do an empirical study assessing the impact of legislative work, even without that, the evidence that legislation is necessary and it may come after the fact, but it has a role in contemporary society and shaping the choices that people have in India. I think that is, that conclusion is inescapable.
Okay, but that's an interesting aspect which Aditi brought out, as in the way, you know, the times are changing, the society is changing, and then with changing times, the need for you know, change in laws as well also becomes evident, and that is where this entire concept of impact assessment comes into play. Chakshu?
Vishal, I think Aditi ma'am makes an extremely valid point. You know, one of the things that we always debate in our country is that the intent of the legislature is great, but the implementation of the law sometimes leaves things to be desired. Mm-hmm. And more so in case of legislation, you know, which are related to technology, which are related to other areas where changes in society are at such a pace that the legislation is not able to keep pace with it. So how do you ensure that, you know, that the law and the society are roughly almost, you know, one step of each other? There has to be some mechanism where legislations are regularly scrutinized to say, oh, you know what, we passed this law in 2005, but in the current context, maybe something needs to be changed. Currently, we do not have institutionalized mechanisms to do that. Let me take an example. The Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Act was passed in the previous Lok Sabha. There have been a number of cases in the High Court. You know, some of the timely processes that were, you know, mentioned in the law are perhaps not being able to be so easily implemented. Mm-hmm. Now, parliamentary standing committees have recently been constituted, and the Committee on Finance, you know, has as one of its subject areas that's going to analyze this year is the working of the, you know, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Act. Similarly, you know, I remember in the previous Lok Sabha, the Committee on Commerce was headed by Mr. Naresh Gujral. His committee had looked at the limited aspect of the working of the GST law when it came to import and exports. The Food Security Act has been, you know, examined. Sometimes these examinations or their post-legislative scrutiny or post-legislative impact assessment is done by Parliament. Sometimes it is done by outside bodies. So, for example, the CAG has done, you know, an impact assessment of a couple of laws as to how they have functioned. Very often, you know, when it comes to technical legislation like the Companies Law, you know, the Ministry of Finance or Commerce, you know, puts together a specialized task force which is made up of industry experts, you know, its own officials, which then gives a report, which then, you know, leads to a change in Parliament.
Okay.
But these are always either processes which are not, you know, institutionalized. For example, you know, for a certain set of legislation, you would like them to be reviewed every 5 years, right? So in many democracies, what legislation start with is they have a sunset clause. Mm-hmm. So the clause will say that this law will come to an end in 5 years unless reviewed by Parliament and, you know, decided to extend their life otherwise. Mm-hmm. So that's one institutionalized, you know, arrangement where Parliament is forced to look at a legislation. The second institutionalized arrangement could be for post, you know, post-legislative impact assessment, could be to empower parliamentary standing committees and say, after a law has been passed, you know, 3 years, 5 years, 7 years after the making of that law, it will have to be looked, you know, by a committee to say, you know, as to what changes are required, especially okay. if it's an original law, mm-hmm. right? Amendment laws, I can still understand that, you know, tweaks are required. But if it's a brand new law, there should be some mechanism to do that. One final point. Very often, if you look at a law, you know, the last two or three clauses of a law is, you know, to allow for the smooth functioning of the law, the government is allowed to make some delegated legislation.
Okay.
But it also contains a law, contains a line by saying that the government will not use this provision after 3 years, mm-hmm. right? The idea being that in 3 years, the law would have stabilized enough. But how do you know as to whether the law is stabilized or not?
That is where the impact assessment comes
in. That is where the impact assessment comes in.
Okay.
And the easiest way to do it would be to put a clause in the law itself saying that an impact assessment of the law will be done after the next number of years.
Okay. Mr. Achary, when we look at, you know, this aspect specifically, as Chakshu has also pointed out, you started with it, institutionalizing the assessment, the impact assessment of legislations. Two points which Chakshu mentioned here is, one, empower the standing committees to go ahead and do a post-legislation assessment again specifically, or maybe put a clause somewhere in the law itself? Which one would be better, or is there some other way we can do it?
Well, if you want to put in place some institutional arrangement for making an impact study of legislations, then certainly the parliament committees, you know, they are there, they can be asked to do this job, nothing wrong about it. But then parliamentary committees are basically examining, you know, for example, the bills which are brought before the House. These are examined by the committees, but then that examination is for a different purpose, make improvement in the bill and all that, you know. that actually is not strictly an impact assessment study.
Mm-hmm. It's a pre-legislation process.
That is the thing. Just to make improvements in the bill as it was introduced in the House. That is the thing. But impact study, you know, that's a it's a much wider term, impact study. You have to go deeper into this, and that has to be done by a very kind of professional kind of body.
Okay.
They will study the impact from various points of view. After all, every law has its own impact on one segment or the other of the society. So that has to be deeply gone into, and then they can certainly give the inputs to the government for bringing about changes in the law.
Mm-hmm.
That will be, I think, the Vice President, Honorable Vice President, is right in thinking about an impact study assessment.
Okay.
Because, of course, we have not given thought to this so far, but that doesn't mean that we should not think about it. This is an idea, I think, which can be seriously discussed. And something can be done about it. That's what I feel.
Okay. So this is an idea whose time seems to have come. Aditi, on this institutionalizing aspect, as in, you know, all of us agree to the fact here that yes, an impact assessment study of the legislations needs to be done. How it has to be done, that aspect, if we look at it.
It's quite complicated, because inevitably when Parliament passes legislation, you don't want to, but you do create vested interests, which then sprout up around that legislation. Maybe vested interest is too strong a word, but people who are invested in that decision that the government has taken, mm-hmm. or that parliament has taken.
Mm-hmm.
Once you have come to that point, to displace those interests can be painful, it can be dangerous, it can be disruptive. It can also be an opportunity. So, what is it that you want to do via this kind of social audit? On the one hand, status quo is good. Parliament, in its wisdom, has passed certain laws, and you know, the idea that big dams are good was the idea at one time. But now we are gradually realizing that big dams are not necessarily always good.
Mm-hmm.
So, but on the other hand, around big dams, there's a whole economy relating to power generation, hydel power generation, relating to resettlement, etc., etc., land prices and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the ecological aspect of it. So, which agency is going to do a social audit? Which agency is going to do an economic audit? Who's going to assess this? It's quite complex.
Okay.
Similarly, many people, many leaders have highlighted the idea of reservation. Some say the reservation should be extended to other areas, including the private sector. Some say it should be curtailed, and you should take a fresh look to see if it's really needed. Now, we have seen with even the limited tinkering with the issue of reservation for those who are socially backward, or those who are economically backward but not socially so, the kind of rage that has been unleashed in society.
But with all these aspects, Aditi, I'd like to take you back to your you know, first comment, when you said that the times are changing, the society is changing, so the laws which govern the society will also have to evolve with time, and for them to evolve, we will also have to assess as to what is it that might benefit the society at large.
Well, whether it benefits in the short run, whether it benefits in the long run, whether it benefits some people, whether it benefits all people equally, whether it benefits. So these are all questions which, you know, we have no answers to right now.
So it's all there in the public domain. It needs to be further debated, discussed.
Exactly. And also, Parliament does not come out of thin air. It is reflective of our society. Mm-hmm. People elect their representatives because they want society to be of a certain kind.
Okay.
So it doesn't come. So in a sense, I cannot say that Parliament is making laws which have negligible impact, social or economic impact. Mm-hmm. Once Parliament makes laws, it is understood that it will have a certain impact.
And then there are, you know, impacts there of all particular laws as well. Let me bring Chakshu here as well. Chakshu, you know, obviously this will need to be further debated, discussed and threshed out as to how this process will take place and all that. But one thing which everybody now seems to come to this agreement is that this kind of assessment is required. You know, the entire lawmaking process does go through a very detailed structure, as in both pre-legislation as well as during the parliamentary standing committee debates and you know, inside the house as well. But assessing the impact is equally important.
Yeah, Vishal, I think, you know, we have a great panel today, and you know, both Achary sir and Aditi ma'am have made some valuable points. To, you know, bring Achary sir's point about an institutionalized mechanism. So for example, in Australia, there is an institution outside of Parliament whose only job is to do, you know, post-legislative assessment of laws passed by the Australian, you know, Parliament. Mm-hmm. Now, the idea is that a dedicated institution will be able to do a better job, will be able to put together its resources in such a manner that for different specialized subjects, it will be able to, you know, bring those in.
Okay.
To, you know, Aditi ma'am's point about the fact that society changes, the parliament changes. Parliament changes every 5 years, or at least, you know, the constitution of parliament for Lok Sabha changes every 5 years. And possibly the idea of a post-legislative impact assessment is to catalyze conversation around issues which might have been legislated previously, but are still relevant, right? So, for example, you know, she referred to the Data Protection Act. Data Protection Act, you know, gets passed today, but it might, you know, the landscape for data protection might completely change in a year's time, or 2 years' time, or a 3 years' time. Mm-hmm. And how will we force the next parliament, or if maybe force is too strong a word, how will we ensure that parliaments pay adequate attention to all issues that it has legislated upon at regular intervals to keep them in relevance, in sync with, you know, the happening of society. Mm-hmm. Can Parliament do it itself? Possibly not. Will Parliament require a lot of support? Absolutely yes. Should it be doing it in some kind of a process which is predefined, right? So, for example, there is this whole conversation about, you know, clearing of insanitary latrines, right? Mm-hmm. We've passed 2 laws about it. Mm-hmm. There are still people who manually, you know, manual scavengers still go and clean latrines. Many of them die in the process of, you know, clearing sewage tanks. There's a law of parliament which says it should not be done. This is a practice which is banned. But there are still people doing it. If there was a post-legislative impact assessment, somebody would have said this law is not working out, you know, as efficiently it was supposed to be. We still have manual scavengers. And then Parliament would have either hauled, you know, the government.
But mostly, Chakshu, we've seen that, you know, in examples like this, which you pointed out, it's basically mostly on some of the occasions we've seen, it's the implementing agencies, the implementation part. The law does state A, B, C, but whether that A, B, C has been implemented in letter and spirit, that's where the question is.
And I think that's the idea of impact, that Parliament intended the law to have a certain impact. Mm-hmm. It promised to the nation that we are passing a law and this is what the law will do for you.
Okay.
We have more than, you know, 1500 central laws in place. And if laws are not serving the intended purpose that they were supposed to serve, then Parliament's accountability responsibility is to look at the government and say, you convinced us, we passed this law. Mm-hmm. Now, how can we ensure that this can be done better?
Okay, so there it is, as our panelists have pointed out. Thank you, Chakshu, PDT Achary, and Aditi for all these views. And clearly, The idea of legislative impact assessment is an idea whose time seems to have come, which will give us an opportunity to see whether these legislations which have been enacted by the parliament or by the legislative assemblies have that desired impact on the society or where it is intended to be. We'll come back again tomorrow with a different topic and different set of guests. Till then, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.